Good morning. Come on, let's stand together and worship together this morning.
Out from the depths into your freedom, our chains are gone. No weapon formed shall prevail. Your word is stronger, we overcome. Saints declaring your great renown. Your kingdom forever will stand. We won't be shaken. We will not fear.
Our God, a mighty warrior, you're a consuming fire.
Triumph in your name.
between us. By the cross you came and broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You called me out of the grave. You called me into the light. You called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Feel the darkness shaking. All the dead are coming back to life. I'm back to life. Hear the song awaken. All creation singing, we're alive. 'Cause you're alive. You called me out of the grave. You called me into the light. You called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. And what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. And what a love. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. And what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger.
He's the God of the valley.
mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn grapes into goddess. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn grapes into goddess. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Into goddess, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into goddess, you turn bones into armies. Turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
Amen. Welcome. We got some of you today. Y'all ready to sit down after the second song? I saw it. Y'all, we're doing three? Welcome. We're so glad to see you today. You're visiting with us. I'm so glad to have you here today. And isn't it good to, I was thinking of when I was a kid, you got this thing where here's the church, here's the steeple, open the doors, and where's all the people? But today we can put the fingers on the inside and all the people are here. It is good to see you. There's a communication card that you can find in the pew rack. If you're visiting with us, we'd love to know more about you. Fill that out so we can see who you are. If you got questions, you can use that to answer that. Church family, if anything's changed, you've moved or have any information's changed or got some things you need to communicate with us, you can use that. And on the back side, as always, prayer requests. We always have them. If you would like those to be prayed over by the pastoral staff, just put those in there. Those communication cards, as well as your tithes and offering, can be placed in the offering plates, which sit in the back, or they can be put through the secret hole in the wall, which is a lot more fun. I highly suggest that. That might inspire you to just give a couple more times, because you can open that up and just put it into the wall. It's mysterious. That's a childlike nature of me, I guess. You know, as we were coming together to worship this morning, I was just thinking about, we come together to corporate worship. This song we just sang, the way the song is set up is you get to proclaim it. You get to really step into it. And we just proclaim together that there's nothing better than the Lord. There's nothing better than you. We proclaimed it over and over and over. And you know what? We proclaimed it, but we got to do more than proclaim it. We got to live it. We got to have actions in our lives that say there's nothing better than you. It shows up in our time. It shows up in how we spend our money. It shows up in the words we choose to use. It shows up in our relationships. You know, when we choose to say the negative things to someone who's just gotten on our last nerves, it's because there's nothing better than us, because we're most important. But when there's nothing better than the Lord, we choose to humble ourselves and to love on that person. Even though we don't feel they deserve the love, we know they do because our Father said they do. Because Jesus Christ died for all mankind. He died for all. The hope of salvation is for all mankind. And we get the grand opportunity to do that. To share that message that Jesus is a Savior for all men, Jew, Gentile, Greek. It doesn't matter where you live, where you're from, what nation you're from, what tongue you speak. It doesn't matter what political party. Jesus is a Savior, not for this world, but for all eternity. Amen? This song that we just sang, that will be on my worship list this week. And I want to remind you, we come together and we worship corporately. That means together. If we don't worship individually throughout the week, we don't really bring nothing to the table. So I really want to stress to you, get your vocal cords warmed up. Do what you got to do. Get Alexa playing, whatever you need to do. Worship during the week. Spend time with them. If you don't sing very good, you know that, get up before everybody so nobody has to hear you. Turn the music up loud, but worship, and that worship will spill over to everything you do. Sing that song in the morning before you hit your day, and see if you don't do more than just proclaim that there's nothing better than you. Amen? Father, we come before you. Lord, we come before you in all truth and honesty as sinners. Lord, the thing we do most naturally and best is sin against you. Lord, we don't brag about that. Lord, we're humbled by that. It terrifies us. It's frustrating to us. So, Lord, this morning, as we are coming to worship you, as we're coming to lean in and get into your word, we use this time right now to confess to you that this week we have done things that were sin against you. Lord, we have an accuser that's always accusing, always accusing, always accusing, but his words don't matter, because you give us the promise that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive all our sins, Lord. And we know that we have forgiveness of sins through Jesus. And Father, as we proclaim through music today words that we mean from our heart, Lord, we ask that you would, with your Holy Spirit, guide our steps this week and let us live that out. Let us not just speak it out, but live it out. Let us be doers of the word and not just hearers. And Father, I lift up Pastor Ian. Lord, may he speak clearly. May he speak with all boldness and confidence what you've laid on his heart. Lord, I thank you for our worship team that continues to lead us. And Lord, I pray that whatever hinders us this morning, whatever's in the way, that we would remove that. Lord, we put our full focus on you, not on the things of this world that so easily entangle and ensnare us, but Lord, we dedicate this time to you. We invite your spirit into this place. We want to worship you. We want to honor you. We want to glorify you. We want to make big of your son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
What a Oh,
Amen. Good to see everyone here this morning on this Valentine's Day, a completely made-up holiday designed to increase sales of cards and cheap chocolate. Some of the most horrendous chocolate you can buy is all in the name of Valentine's Day. Bad chocolate. And I know chocolate. Well, I hope you have had a wonderful day so far as we have come back together after some serious cases of the Rona. So glad all those folks are back up and running. And we are glad to see you. If it would help, just hold your breath while you're here. And then once you leave, you can let it all out. Remember, the Rona hovers between 5 and 6 feet. You're sitting, you're safe. If you're walking through a restaurant, bad. But sitting, it's all good. If you wear a mask, it's good. Double masks are better. Triple masks are 9 times more effective. And wearing 4 masks is proven to be 18 times more effective for stopping or not the coronavirus. We don't really know. But follow the science, please, everybody. Just thought I'd throw that out there. Hey, if you feel safe wearing a mask, by all means, please, please wear a mask. It's okay. We won't make fun of you. We won't say you don't have faith. We won't say any of those nonsensical things. If you feel more comfortable wearing a mask, do it. If you don't want to wear a mask, don't. I don't care. Do what makes you feel more comfortable. Last week, old Pastor Mark was preaching, and he told us that Jesus found Philip, who then found Nathanael. Philip told Nathanael, they found the one that Moses spoke of in the law and the prophets, this Jesus of Nazareth. Nathanael asked Philip that very famous question, can anything good come from Nazareth? We saw the encounter between Philip and Jesus, with Philip confirming that Jesus was the Son of God. This morning, we'll see Jesus attend a wedding where he performs the first of many signs or miracles. But the passage is incredibly significant outside of the miracles. So turn your Bibles to John chapter 2. We're going to look at the first 11 verses. And you might be thinking this is an awful strange passage to be preaching from on this first day back as we're all together. It has nothing to do with anything other than how the calendar works. There's a Sunday that comes after a Saturday. And someone this morning, I think it was Becky, said, so what is the, Becky, Nick, somebody, Nick was praying for us after rehearsal this morning. He said, you know, I don't know who's preaching, but whoever it is, I have no idea, but I pray, Lord, that you would give them the words to speak, something like that. And I said, it just goes to show you, nobody pays attention who's preaching. And Becky said, no, it goes Zane, Ian, Mark, or Mark, Zane, Ian. And I said, well, Zane said, no, it's actually, it goes Mark, Ian, Zane, or Ian, Zane, Mark. It doesn't matter how, whoever you start with, it's the same three guys. Who cares? I enjoy listening to them. I learn things from them. And you know, if you're counting down, we are in a three-section rotation. Ian, Zane, Mark. Ian, Zane, Mark. Without fail. We do not deviate. We do not allow any leading of the Holy Spirit. This is how it goes. Of course, that's nonsense. It's just a schedule. Zane, sometimes when he's getting really ahead in his preparation, he'll start on Friday for the Sunday message. If he's really feeling confident, he'll just wait till after Sunday school before he preaches Sunday. He said, I got plenty of time. I got that break between Sunday school and church. Whereas I, on the other hand, I prefer to look ahead at least to the change of season. I like to be at least 3 weeks ahead, or I'm sorry, 3 months ahead, because you never know what's going to happen. You could have a pipe burst at the house. You could have someone in the hospital.
You can have problems with your eyes where you just can't see coming into work. I mean, there's some serious things that could happen. I like to be far ahead. All right, John chapter 2, are you there? Pretty excited? Anybody have a nauseous feeling in their stomach about what we're going to talk about today? I don't. Maybe you don't know what chapter 2, verses 1 through 11 are all about. Let's read them. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said, "Woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were 6 stone water pots set there for the Jewish custom of purification, containing 20 or 30 gallons each. Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." So they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it to him. When the head waiter tasted the water, which had become wine, and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Every man serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then he serves the poor wine, but you have kept the good wine until now." This beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Today's title will come as no shock: the first miracle. Will you pray with me? Father, we are grateful to be here, Lord, thankful to be back together in the fellowship made possible by the blood of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the ability to come together. We seek your blessing upon the preaching of your word, the singing of your word, the prayers that we have lifted up. And Father, what is accomplished here today, we give you the glory, honor, and praise. For we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. As we continue in our study of John, we need to be careful about time references. It's easy to get hung up on references like this one we see here as the third day. The third day of what? Of Jesus' public ministry? The third day of the week? The third day of John's narrative? The third day after calling Philip and Nathanael? Obviously, the third day carries significance. There was a group of guys that came together and formed a band called Third Day. The third day carries significance for believers. It was the third day of traveling that Abraham and Isaac arrived at the destination God told them to go. It was the third day that Laban was told that Jacob had left. It was the third day that Simeon and Levi killed all the men of Shechem as payback for what Shechem, the son of Hamor the Hivite, did to Dinah. Joseph originally put his brothers in prison for 3 days. Esther called for a fast for 3 days and 3 nights. Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and 3 nights. This 3-day period is also important in the Gospel of John. It's tied closely to the hour John mentions in today's passage. So when, you ask, are these 3 days? The truth, emphatically, is we do not know. But some people will point to this lack of certainty as a reason to be critical of the narrative. Now, it's okay to say, you know what, any of those times could be the one we're talking about, but don't focus so much on the time. Focus on the story. John is written as a narrative. It's not written as a reporter giving the facts and laying all things out. He's a guy. He's writing as he sees it. Remember, and I want you to keep this in the forefront of your mind as we go through John, remember the theme of John, found in John 20, verse 30 and 31. Therefore, many other signs Jesus performed in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Everything in this book points to that one theme, that you can know who Jesus is, get to know him better, more intimately, so that you can have life in the name of Jesus. We know there's power in the name of Jesus. We know that at the name of Jesus, every tongue will confess, every knee will bow at the name of Jesus. That's why John's writing. Remember that as we move through. So there's a wedding. I mean, weddings are a big deal. In the newspaper, you often find the details of the wedding, that the bride wore a white dress with a 6-foot train. That's the part that falls behind, guys. She had a veil, and it was made by this, and the bridesmaids wore this dress and carried these flowers, and I have read those and thought, who really cares? But somebody cares. I mean, the wedding is an important day, right? I mean, you married people who are, or let's see, you're not married yet. Is there anybody engaged to be married? Does anybody want to be engaged to be married? Okay, do I have a guy and a girl equally wanting to be engaged? And we'll set it up right here. There's something to be said for arranged marriages. Nobody here getting ready to be engaged. Well, there are people that think about their wedding from the time they are little kids, about what it'll be like. So we have a wedding in the town of Cana. Cana was a small town in the region of Galilee. It's an area of about 108 square miles. It was the region east of the Sea of Galilee, bordered by the Jordan to the west, the Mediterranean to the east, Samaria to the south, and Syria to the north. It's a specific area. Jesus spent his childhood in the southern half, specifically in Nazareth. So on the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. And the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. All right, so everybody knows the mother of Jesus is Mary. She is a regular old gal that became pregnant with Jesus through a supernatural, spectacular miracle, and she was a virgin when she conceived. We all know Mary. She is important. She is special. She is not superior to all of you. She is a regular gal. Don't pray to her. Do not worship her. You can acknowledge her. She's a mom. Any moms? Moms in here? You guys are special, right? We love moms. I had a mom. Everybody has to have a mom. So they're all there. At this point, Jesus has 5 disciples for sure. We know there's John, Andrew, Peter, Philip, and Nathaniel. Jesus and the 5 were invited to the wedding. It seems that Mary may have been a wedding planner because she was not invited, but she was there. She may have had something to do with the wedding, so she didn't need an invitation. Now, if there's a wedding, I'll just tell anybody planning a wedding, parents, you know, get ready. If you have kids that are of wedding age, Facebook invitations do not count. For invitations, okay? They don't count. You need to be invited to a wedding in order to attend. If you do not have an invitation and you go to the wedding, you are a wedding crasher, okay? Don't do that, and we're going to see why in a moment. Mary was in some role of authority. She could make things happen. Now, back then, back in the olden days, weddings were a big deal. They could last several days up to a week. I mean, this was a big festival, a big deal. All the town would be there. Everybody would be taking part. So Jesus and the 5, it seems like they must have known the bride and or the groom in order to be invited. Philip, Andrew, and Peter were all from Bethsaida. It looks like Nathaniel was from Cana. At the very least, the organizer of the wedding knew Mary. She had something to do with the wedding. So perhaps Jesus got an invitation by being her son, and then the disciples went because they were attached to Jesus. So we're not exactly sure how they go, but, you know, you may go to a wedding where you know the bride or groom, but you get to bring your spouse. It would be really weird to say, hey, Pastor Mark, we want you to go to a wedding. Marcia, you're not invited. That would be weird. I have officiated at weddings where I go, and they'll ask me, where's Carrie? She wasn't invited. I am officiating at the wedding. I am not going to eat your dry chicken. I'm not going to be there at the reception. I'm not going to be. I am here to do my job, and then I am leaving. Y'all can have at it. This would be weird just to crash the wedding. So somehow there had to be a connection. So weddings today are a big deal, if you didn't know. I mean, we put articles in the paper about what everybody wore. The furry tuxedo. You remember the furry tuxedos that they wore back when I was a kid? Baby blue tuxedo. I mean, that was a big deal with the fringe on the shirt. You remember in your high school prom? You know, probably Mark, you may have worn a fringy, didn't wear a fringy thing? That was before your time. So Gary, apparently, that was during your time? During my time, too. Baby blue was the thing, man. I mean, that was big time. Sometimes you had a furry lapels and a furry tie. I mean, it was very fancy in the old days. Now, as a father of a bride, I am glad that they do not last 7 days. Mark's got a daughter. Zane's got a daughter. Josh Redding has 42 daughters. Josh has 4 daughters. You people that have more than one girl in the family, God bless you. Save now. Or just say, look, I'll give you $500 if you just elope. Daughters, use that as leverage. You know, $500 really doesn't go as far as it used to. I'm thinking $1,500 is more appropriate. Or maybe $2,000. Man, I would have given Amelia $5,000. Just take the $5,000. It would have saved me money. And Amelia's wedding was very, very reasonable. I mean, you know me. I'm not one of them frou-frou guys where here's $300,000, have fun. I mean, there are people spending. Have you ever watched My Big Fat Greek Wedding? $10,000 is chump change. They spend that on the consultant of what hors d'oeuvres to have. Weddings are a big deal. I'm glad I only have one daughter. People have used this passage to affirm the need to invite Jesus to the wedding. People have used this passage as a proof text that the church should be over weddings. In fact, Reverend Kenneth Newton, on May 17th in 1986, at my marriage ceremony to my Valentine, he used this passage, referred to Jesus performing his first miracle at a wedding. This is a very famous thing. Still, others have affirmed that marriage should be between a man and a woman based on this passage. I submit to you, there are way more better passages to use than this passage about marriage being between a man and a woman. So the wine runs out. The mother of Jesus says to him, they have no wine. Now this was bad. For a wedding festival to last a week, you think about the amount of food and beverages necessary to supply all that is needed for a week's time. This could be a really embarrassing moment for the host. To run out of provisions was awkward, rude, terrible. I mean, I've been to those weddings. 70 people, and there's a bowl of peanuts for everybody to share. You don't take one peanut. You have to take one for your family. Bowl of peanuts, and then there's a bowl of those mints. You know those mints that melt in your mouth that you used to get them at the cash register, now they're all individually wrapped? They've got a bowl of nuts, a bowl of mints. And if you're thirsty, there's a drinking fountain on the wall. Help yourself. That's embarrassing. I've been to the weddings where it's a wedding at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon and there's no food. Are you out of your mind? All the people, all you hear is the rumbling of stomachs, and then the wedding's over and you're expecting to get something to eat. Something, give me something. I don't care if it's an uncooked piece of pasta. Give me something to eat. I'll eat last week's donuts. Well, that's a bad example because I actually would eat last week's donuts. I've been to the weddings where you can't eat anything until the bride and groom gets there. It's been 3 hours, people. I'm ordering a pizza. Who's in with me? I've been to those weddings. Don't be that guy, because you will become an illustration and a message at some point in the future. So this turn of events could prove socially disastrous for the hosts, and Mary does something about it. Now, I think this is quite ominous. I think this is a good time to talk about the issue with wine. The point of the story is not the wine, but I think we need to spend a moment or two talking about it. As a believer, what should you do with the issue of alcohol? In the Old Testament, there are four Hebrew words used for wine. Yayin is a general term used for wine. It's used 141 times. The word always means fermented juice, typically of the grape. It's used in Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, and a host of other places. Tarosh is new wine. Because of the climate of the region back in the day, the fermentation process could begin as early as 6 hours after crushing. They had no way to preserve the fruit juice. So this word is used to refer to that new wine that's just squeezed or that is just at the beginning of the fermentation process. It's used in Deuteronomy, Isaiah, Hosea, among others. Asis is used in Joel and Isaiah. And it's always clearly alcoholic. Sikar is used for strong drink. It has something added to make it more intoxicating. The words drunk and drunkard come from the same root word. In the New Testament, just two words for wine. One is oinos. It's the Greek word, means the same as the Hebrew word yayin. It means fermented fruit juice. Glucose is unfermented juice of grapes, found in Acts 2:13 and referred to as sweet wine. So if you remember that fruit juice takes about 6 hours for that fermentation process to begin, the initial process of fermentation takes about a day. It is completed after 40 days and is referred to as aged wine. So how can we apply biblical truth regarding wine to modern day culture? Where now you can go to a drive-thru and get wine or alcohol or beer. Drunkenness is always condemned in the Bible. Make no mistake. Every single time. I can mention Genesis 9:21 when Noah got drunk and took off his clothes. We can talk about Lot's daughters in Genesis 19 that got their father drunk, then slept with him to preserve their family line. Matthew 24:49 talks about the evil slave that got tired of waiting for the master, so he beats his fellow slaves and drinks with the drunkards. In speaking of the kingdom of God, Jesus warned his disciples to be on guard so that your hearts will not be weighted down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of life. Paul told the church at Corinth not to associate with a drunkard. 1 Corinthians 5:11. He goes on in 6:10 to say that drunks would not inherit the kingdom of God. He told the Galatians the same thing in Galatians 5:21. Peter equates drunkenness with a desire of the Gentiles. And I could go on and on. Some people will quote Ephesians 5:18, "Be not drunk with wine," as justification to get drunk using other sources. Well, that doesn't say I couldn't, you know, pack down this Boone's Farm 2020. No, that was Mad Dog, right? Mad Dog 2020. If you don't know what I'm talking about, hallelujah. We have wine in a box. There are now clubs for, well, I guess there are wine clubs that you can get, you know, the wine of the month. You can get hard drink, liquor of the month. You know, you're in your scotch club or your bourbon club. You know, what do we do with this that we're inundated with alcohol? I think most folks would conclude that it is not a sin to drink alcohol. It's not a sin. As long as you don't get drunk. I'm not going to disagree with that. Not at all. But I want to offer some wisdom. I'm old. I've been around for nearly 6 decades. I'll be 58 next month. Please don't do what you did last year and wait till the last minute to shop for my birthday. Don't wait. It's March 24th. People talk about the liberty they have in Christ. I agree. We have liberty in Christ. But liberty comes with responsibility. Paul warned the Corinthians that using liberty could be a stumbling block to others. Jude talked about using grace as license. He said, "I really wanted to write to you guys and talk about our common salvation. I really wanted to. I mean, our salvation is awesome. But I am compelled to write to you about certain people that have crept in unnoticed, that are turning the grace of God into licentiousness." King James says lasciviousness. It means license to sin. I have liberty to do many things. The people in Jude's day reasoned that I'm saved by grace. Grace is unmerited favor. I can't do anything to earn it. I can't earn grace. Therefore, grace can't be taken away from me. It's all about grace. And they use grace as license to sin, reasoning, since I cannot earn grace, I cannot lose grace, therefore I can do whatever I want. And that was their license, their card-carrying permission to do whatever they want, knowing that their salvation could not be taken away because we are saved by grace through faith. It's not of yourselves. Drunkenness is always wrong, and I think everyone would agree. You have the liberty to drink alcohol as long as it doesn't lead to drunkenness. How do you know when you cross the line from liberty to license? How do you know when you cross the line of drunkenness, enjoying a drink? When does it become drunkenness? Do we follow Georgia law that says you can have a blood alcohol content of 0.08, which is legally drunk to drive? Lori will tell you that the legal limit for a commercial driver is 0.04. Can I tell you that if you weigh up to 240 pounds, one drink can give you a blood alcohol content of 0.035, and research has shown that at 0.035, it causes significant impairment in the ability to steer a vehicle. At what limit do you go? Do we carry a portable breath tester? We blow in it. Oh, man. I'm at 0.079999. I better back off a little bit or have a burrito. Because never drink on an empty stomach. Maybe you only drink for the health benefits. Pastor Ian, my doctor, says I should drink because it's for my health. Okay. The Mayo Clinic says some research studies suggest that red and purple grape juices may provide the same heart benefits as red wine. You're just drinking the wine for the polyphenols. That's the things in there that helps your heart. You can get those same polyphenols from things like nuts. Not at a wedding because there aren't enough. From nuts and vegetables. From beans. I mean, share the polyphenols with everybody by eating beans and lots of them. It'll do your heart good. Give me another helping of the beans, man. It's not 3-bean salad. Let's make it 6-bean salad. That's good for the heart. Those polyphenols can also be found in dark chocolate. Slather properly on a fried ring of dough. In referring to our Christian walk, says Paul says we may have the liberty to eat or drink. We have that liberty. But not all things are profitable for the body of Christ. Not all things are edifying. Your pastor's room office this morning talking about this very issue, and I've thought about this in the past. You know, even people who drink socially, and we're not mad with you. We don't think you're awful heathen jerks. We don't think that at all. I wonder, would anybody have a problem when Clyde makes coffee every Sunday if there would just be a bottle of wine there too? Would that be a problem? Or at our next fellowship, and we're looking at doing some things for Easter and Easter egg hunt, we're kicking around some things on what to do, would it be okay to have a fellowship and, you know, right next to the sweet tea and lemonade, there's a fifth of scotch and some Sauvignon Blanc. Is that something? Or, you know, the other thing. Would that be okay? I mean, if it's okay to drink alcohol, and I'm telling you, I'm here to tell you, I do not believe drinking alcohol is a sin. But would it be okay to serve it at a fellowship meal at the church? Well, Pastor Ian, that wouldn't be a good idea. And that's what we're talking about. What is wise in our Christian walk? For me, I can only tell you for me, drinking is reminiscent of my life before I chose to follow Christ. I had my last drink of alcohol in June 1983. I was saved in December 1983. My first drink, I've shared this before, was at about 8 years old. There was only one or two brands of cough syrup out there, so when we had a cough, my mom made cough syrup. It was like half vodka, a couple tablespoons of lemon, and a couple tablespoons of honey. And, you know, during the winter time, I felt like, Mom, I'm really feeling a little bit under the weather. Mix me up some of that concoction stuff that you got going. See, for me, it's reminiscent of who I was before I became a believer. It's a reminder of what I was, not who I am. I've witnessed alcohol destroy careers. I've witnessed alcohol destroy families. I've witnessed alcohol destroy finances. I know you are different, and it cannot happen to you. If I can just give you one suggestion, please refrain from posting pictures of yourself with alcohol on social media. Because that stumbling block verse is not just about those who stumble because of what they see. It's also about our responsibility to not be a stumbling block. One final thought on this, and I know you are eagerly anticipating the finish. How will your life be negatively impacted by abstaining from alcohol? I don't know a single drunk that I have arrested that says, man, I really made good decisions while I was drunk. Misty can share with you all of the stories that of people she has arrested for driving under the influence, and you think nobody drives under the influence anymore. We've been taught from school, from way, way yonder, little kids, don't drink and drive. Everybody knows that. We probably have in St. Mary's 4 or 5 DUIs every week. That's just St. Mary's. There are multiple DUIs still in 2021 that are shocking. I stopped a guy doing 101 miles an hour on St. Mary's Road. He was in front of Sugar Mill, and he was going to Osprey Cove, and he was going the wrong way. See, alcohol impairs your judgment, and research has shown that even one drink impacts your ability to make good decisions. And that often makes that bad decision leads to another drink, and another drink, and another drink. And if you call me, because I'm the pastor on call, and you call me at 10 o'clock in the morning, I say, you know, I would love to come help for you for your emergency, but, you know, after coffee, I cracked open a brewski, and I'm just watching the game. Yeah, but it's 10 o'clock in the morning. But if it's okay to drink, is there a time limit in Scripture? Do you see how we can just nitpick, and you sure don't want me to not be able to come to your house because I've been drinking, or you sure don't want to be called into work and, well, I can't go because I'm drinking, and every time you get called into work, you're drinking, guess what they're going to think? Well, that's on them. Remember, how will your life be negatively impacted by abstaining from alcohol? If you would like to chat with me in private about that, I'd be delighted. But for now, we will move back to the wedding. An awkward situation has arisen. Mary tells Jesus, "We are out of wine." Maybe you've been in a similar situation. What's that got to do with me? For whatever reason, the person tells you whatever, thinks you are part of the solution. Pastor Mark, we're out of curriculum. What's that got to do with me? Your lack of planning has nothing to do with me. Listen to Jesus' response to Mary. Woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come. Early in my now nearly 35-year marriage, I often referred to Carrie as woman for fun. It was always in a loving, joking context. It was no big deal. What's wrong with that? Tiana, what is the problem with that, woman? You're a woman, right? Listen, woman, let me tell you something. I did that with Carrie, and it was about 27 years ago or so. It was cold. He was wearing just a diaper. He was 3 years old or so, four-ish. And Carrie told him to do something. It required going up the stairs in Groton, Connecticut. We lived in housing. See, this has made no impact on my memory at all. He goes up the stairs, and he stops, and he turns around, and he says, "Look, woman, I was not home at the time, but the story was related to me, and it's kind of a blur. I'm not exactly sure what happened, but I stopped saying that. Because in our culture, saying woman, hey, listen, woman, it's taken on a very negative, disrespectful tone. But in Jesus' day, now don't think, well, Jesus said it, so it's good enough for me. That's not what this means. It was a term of endearment. Believe it or not, it was a term of respect. Woman, what's that got to do with me? He'll use it again in chapter 19. It was not disrespectful, but in our reading, it's really, really weird. So he says, what's that got to do with us? At first glance, I mean, rude, disrespectful. Jesus, I thought you were sinless. And here you're snippy with your mama. I mean, today you might get the backside of a hand. You might get a wooden spoon. You might get a hairbrush. You might get a belt, but generally only the dads use the belt. Grandmas only use a switch. It's a generational thing. I used a glare that worked with Amelia. I think I spanked Amelia twice in her whole life. Seth, bless him. But Amelia, I could just give her a glance. And you've got kids like that. If that's what works, that's fine. Jesus, what's that got to do with us? Men, if your wife tells you, honey, the trash can is full, and you respond with, what's that got to do with me? Life will not be good. Honey, the grass needs cutting. What's that got to do with me? Honey, my car's making a funny noise. Woman, what's that got to do with me? Honey, there's dirty clothes in the hamper. Just throwing that out there. God don't mean anything by it. What do you do all day? Don't say those things. Man, you got youngsters at home. Men, never, ever in a million years, never, ever go in, look around and say, darn, honey, what you been doing all day? Don't ever do that. It will lead to pain and suffering. Don't do that. But ladies, it's okay to put down your phone and do the dishes. Just throwing that out there. I can tell you why there's a lot of people's houses are in a wreck. Back when my kids were little, there was no cell phones. I gotta go because your phone cord's only so long. Gotta go. The washing machine stopped. I gotta get clothes on the line. I gotta take others off the line. We didn't have time in the old days. Put your darn phones down. I speak also of myself. What's that got to do with me? The goal is to elicit a response without the dreaded nagging. No man wants to be nagged. Nobody does. So men, don't force your wife to ask you to do something that's your job more than once. In fact, if the trash can's full, y'all, this is what we do. Ladies, this is what we do. You see the trash can's full? What do, guys? Yeah. Smush it down. That's what we do. Hey, the toilet's clogged. Shut the door. That's what men do. So guys, if you see the trash can and it's full, don't think, well, it's a 50-pound bag and there's only 49 and a half pounds in it, so I'm going to mush it down. Just take the darn trash out. It's plastic. It's not like you have to go to the burn barrel. You pick it up, you spin it, and you tie the handles, and you walk the 12 feet to the trash can that the dude comes and picks up every week. It's easy. You see the clothes in the dryer? They're the burn. Just pop up, go take them out, put them in the laundry basket that literally is right there, and carry them in. Dump them on the bed and say, honey, get going. No, don't do that. Don't do the last part. Don't do the last part. Don't do that part. Just skip that part. Honey, there's clothes on the bed. It's used to elicit a response. So Mary says, they have no wine. She's thinking Jesus is going to do something. Probably not the response that she was expecting. Their problem of having no wine has nothing to do with us, Jesus tells her, and the reason is because my hour has not yet come. It's not ready. As we continue in our study of John, we'll learn that Jesus' primary mission is to do the will of his Father. Jesus' mom's speaking to him, and in all likelihood, dad's out of the picture. Joseph has probably died. He's not mentioned. There are certain things that you can say in the home that are not appropriate in public. You probably know what those are. Jesus' hour had not yet come. So let me summarize this. Jesus and his disciples are at a wedding festival. We don't know how long it's been going on. Amidst all the celebration and days long, they have run out of wine. Mary is in some form of responsibility or authority, and she goes to Jesus thinking that it's going to fix the problem. Does Mary know who she is talking to? Of course she does. It's Jesus, her son. Does she know who Jesus is? I think about Clark Kent's parents. Do they know who he is? There's just some guy that came in a capsule. He's an alien being. Do they know who Superman is? Well, Jesus is more better than Superman. Does Mary know who he is? Can this potentially disastrous social issue be resolved? His mother said to the servants, whatever he says, do it. I don't know if there was some kind of indication that's not put in the scriptures that maybe he gave a look or nod, something, but Mary is confident that Jesus is going to fix the issue, so it kind of gives us an indication that she knows who he is, but he takes care of it. Mary disappears from the rest of the story. Because the point of the story is not the wedding, it's not the wine, and it's not the woman. The point of the story is Jesus. So the stage is set for something incredible to happen. There are 6 water pots off to the side for the Jewish custom of purification. They each contain 20 to 30 gallons. This is a Jewish wedding ceremony. The water pots were there for purification. They have to be made out of stone because if they were earthenware, they would be unclean. Tough to purify something with something unclean. Jesus tells the servants, fill the water pots with water. So they fill them. I mean, this is literal. Fill them up. When we say fill up a glass, we go up and it's about 7/8. If you're pouring milk for a kid, you never go past a half because you're smart. You know that's more that your wife's going to have to clean up. By the way, parenting is a 2-person venture. That doesn't mean mom works twice as hard. It's a mom and a dad, 2 people working together, giving 100-100. It's hard. You know, Mark is back. Welcome home, Mark. Mark was out there defending freedom in a Rona-free environment. And Gabby was serving as mom and dad to Rory. That's the life of a military family. You got to do things yourself. And you may have a spouse that works out of town, and you got to pull up all the slack. It's hard. So I know Gabby is glad you're back. I am glad you're back, and I am certain Rory is also glad you're back. Fill the water pots up. So they fill them. Remember, Mary, She has something to do with this wedding, so she's guiding all this stuff. She is taking care of it. So they fill up the water pots and put as much water in them as possible. Now, once filled, Jesus says, hey, draw some water out and take it to the head waiter. I mean, this was a fancy, I mean, they had, Mary was like the wedding planner. They've got a head waiter. I mean, this is big time. He's probably the guy that makes sure that the chicken wings are in the pot, make sure there's enough mac and cheese, and he's continuing to add stuff to make sure everything goes without a hitch, right? So they fill them up with as much water, they take some water out, and they bring it to the head waiter, who tasted the water, which had become wine. He didn't know where it had come from, but the servants who drew the water knew, because they were the ones that filled up with water. So the head waiter calls the bridegroom. So at some point between the water's getting filled up to the brim, them taking the water and taking it to the head waiter, it became wine. It had miraculously, supernaturally become wine, and there is no possible way this is fruit juice. This is alcoholic wine, and I know you have probably heard people preach in the past that this was just fruit juice. I submit to you that you are not going to get drunk, because the head waiter tells the bridegroom, dude, you got it going on, man. Normally, you bring out the poor wine later, because once people are schnockered, they don't care what they're drinking. They could be drinking liquid vomit, and they would be happy. That's what alcohol does, y'all. And you've seen the pictures, right? There's a pretty girl when you're, there's a really ugly girl when you're not drunk, a real pretty girl when you're drunk. People in authority do whatever they can to get you to understand that driving while impaired is deadly. You can lose your job, lose your security clearance. It can be embarrassing. It'll cost you for at least 7 years a DUI conviction. But please, by all means, hire the lawyer for $3,500 to get that officer to plead down to reckless and take every other charge there. It's still going to cost you about $4,500 just in fees and citations, and then you've got the added bonus of the insurance going up every single year. Congratulations. I'm so glad that you felt socially responsible to get drunk. I know I said I was done with that. I'm sorry. Head waiter, man, every man serves good wine first. When people have drunk freely, then he serves the poorer wine. But you, man, you have kept the good wine until now. That makes sense, right? Good wine is presumably more expensive. Harder to keep. Bring out the poor quality, man. What the bridegroom says, we don't know. Because the story is over. Almost. Remember, the story is not about the wedding, although weddings are important. I think weddings are good. The point of the story is not the social awkwardness that may have been felt by the host. The focus of the story is not that Jesus should be a part of every marriage, although he should. The point of the story is not that the church should participate in every wedding, although that's not bad either. The story is not an endorsement of social drinking. Point of the story is not an endorsement of getting drunk. That's not the point. Verse 11 is the point. This beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Jesus knew that his disciples would need to see things to believe. And don't get all high and mighty and say that you're so much more faithful than they are. How many times have you asked Jesus for a sign? Lord, just give me a sign. But we make it spiritual and we throw out the fleece. You're wanting a sign. You want Jesus to do something special for you that he has recorded. We walk by faith, not by sight. So why are you asking for a sign? Because it's a lot easier to believe when you can see it right in front of you. But wasn't it Thomas that said, hey, let me just stick my fingers. Let me just touch you. I want to feel your scars. And Jesus said, well, Thomas, blessed are you that see and believe, but blessed are those that do not see yet believe. Y'all, we walk by faith, not by sight. This is a faith walk. It is a choice that we will choose to believe the supernatural character of Jesus and who he is and trust in what he has done, that we do have recorded historical fact on what Jesus did. You can believe that, or you can ask him for all the signs in the world and he may or may not do it. Is that going to affect your faith walk? Well, if he would only answer my prayers, I submit to you that he does. But my experience is we only say he doesn't answer our prayers when he doesn't answer them the way we tell him he needs to answer them. He answered, y'all, it's guaranteed in his word that he will answer your prayers. He will always answer the prayers of his followers. It just may not be your answer that you're looking for. Jesus knew what his disciples needed. The point of the story is Jesus. That's the point of all our stories in Scripture, is to help us know who Jesus is, to get to know him more intimately, to trust him, have faith in who he is, because he is the Son of God. Pray with me. Father, I know it seems like many times we say this, a message like this, Lord, it wasn't directed at anyone or anybody or anything, but Lord, we're simply taking the truths found in Scripture and sharing how to apply them to our lives, sharing what they mean and how we can learn and grow from it. So Lord, I pray that the words that I chose, Lord, as I believe that you led, Lord, I pray that we would understand my heart for sharing, understand the intention that you have in providing this story in Scripture. And Lord, most of all, I pray that our faith would grow, that our Christ-likeness would be even more manifested than it was when we got here, that people would look at us and know that we are children of God. Father, I pray for each of us as we move out in this week, that we would have opportunities to share the truth of who you are. And Father, I pray that truth would be evident in our lives, that we would live by faith. So Lord, help us. Help us in this faith walk. In Jesus' name, amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of every praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is the
is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
As we quickly go over our announcements. Now, last week I said we'd have men, and women tomorrow. And I forgot that tomorrow was the day we celebrate all presidents. And tomorrow is a holiday, so no men, women. But there is our Converge Youth. They'll be here tonight. All the little student people, they'll be here. Bible study, no Bible study tonight because of the holiday. And then Wednesday we have Awana. There's Tuesday praise band practice, and I think everything now is all normal. And Friday night happens, what is Friday night?
We've got a youth fundraiser for World Changers, that we've got a babysitting night. So any parents that want to drop their kids off, there will be adults, not just teens here.
Oh, I turned that. Hello, people at home. Hello. Okay, so Friday night, we've got a teen fundraiser. We're going to be going to World Changers this summer, and we need to raise some money, so we're going to work for it. So we're going to do a babysitting night on Friday night. There will be adults here. It won't just be a bunch of teens and children. They've all been approved. So, but we are going to be doing games. We're going to have movie. We're going to have story. We're going to have a lot of fun. And parents, this is a good opportunity. Yeah, we will have food. If you want pizza, if you want your children to eat with us, it's $2 a person for pizza. If you want to bring your own lunchbox for your kids, if they've got special foods they need to eat, you can bring that. But parents, it's a good opportunity for you guys to have a date night at home. If you just want to be, you know, away from your kids for a little while, we will play with them.
Yeah, so drop your kids off, and then y'all go have fun and hang out and do whatever you like. That's, what, 9 hours long, 10 hours long?
It's 5 to 9.
5 to 9, that's just 4 hours.
Any children after 9 will go to Pastor Ian's house.
All right, and you know, I'll take care of them good.
Is there an age limit?
There is no age. If you want to drop your husband off here. Ladies, you want to drop your husband off?
We've offered that as well because a couple.
They'll feed them.
Couple wives online.
Well, you know,
that.
Men generally are completely helpless without their wives. It's like, oh, you open the fridge. It's like, I don't know what to eat. Carrie always tells me that. She said, there's stuff in the freezer. I said, I don't know the freezer. The freezer holds ice cream. Apparently, you store food in there and then it thaws and you make it into a meal. It's
amazing.
Crazy. I don't really do that stuff. There's lots of good stuff on Friday night. So if you want to drop your kids off and go do whatever you need to do, maybe, you know, Christmas shopping or whatever, get a jump on it, man. While you're Christmas shopping, remember my birthday is in March. So normal schedule after Monday night, normal schedule from here on out. So look forward to seeing everybody here. Next Sunday, we are dedicating babies. It's going to be a baby dedication. So if you haven't let Vicky know, please let Vicky know. Let's say no later than Tuesday, and then have your kid all well-napped, well-fed, because we will not tolerate crying during baby dedication. Actually, we will. Last baby dedication we have, I don't know if you remember. We got to go because Kara's actually in the back. There was half a dozen kids, and it was just the kids talking to one another, and it was like a literal circus in here, and I was sitting right there because I was supposed to pray at the end, and I was just, maybe we'll show the video one day, I was just laughing and couldn't stop just because it was so, I mean, it was cute, it was fun, but we don't want it like that every Sunday. It's okay to do it once in a while. So baby dedication, email Vicky at office@threerivers.life and let her know so that we can make sure we have appropriate, the gift certificates for the college education all filled out properly. It's a college of life, because Cam's like, I think I want to get dedicated. That doesn't count. Doesn't count. All right, I think that's it. Is that it, everybody? Perfect. Today's Valentine's Day. Give your Valentine a hug. Let's stand and we'll be dismissed. You don't have to. It's a made-up holiday, okay? Let's pray. Father, we are grateful to be here. Lord, thank you for the just the wonderful time we've had through Sunday school and prayer and singing and Lord, through your word. Lord, thank you for all that you are doing in our congregation. Lord, I pray blessings upon our church family. Pray blessings upon everyone represented here. And Lord, as we leave this place, as Pastor Mark mentioned earlier, I pray that we would be doers of God's word and not hearers only. In Jesus' name, amen.